Welcome to the lecture series on Artificial Neural Network. Today is the third lecture in the same lecture series. In the last lecture, we had concluded the introductory part of an artificial neural network. And in the second lecture, we had gone through, that is, the training an artificial neural network, then Mokolovitz neuron model we had seen along with some examples and the logical gate implementation. Then we had gone through the application of neural networks and the comparison of artificial neural networks and biological networks. In today's lecture, we are supposed to start with the learning rules, and in the learning rules we will start with the general learning rules, that is an Emery's general learning rule, and then we will go for a Hare learning rule. So let us go with the introduction part. Now see that every neuron is considered to be an adaptive element. Means, depending on the problem statement and to provide solution to a problem, the weight of the neuron is to be adjusted. So we can see that the neuron's weights can be modified depending on the input signal it receives, its output value, and the associated teacher response. In some cases, if the teacher is not there, then in those cases, the neuron will modify its weight based on the input and or output. So basically, how exactly the weights are being modified to get the desired output, or to find out the exact weight to solve a problem, that can be done by using a learning rule. So let us proceed further with the first learning rule. So let us start with, that is, Emery's general learning rule. Now, consider a single layer feed forward neural network consisting of n input neurons, and we are having m output neurons. So we are considering this neural network, and in this network we are having x1 till xi, xn are the inputs to the input neurons, that is x1, xi and xn. And on the output side we are having the output neurons, that is y1, yj and ym. And the output to that corresponding neurons are y1, yj and ym. Now this is a feed forward neuron, means always the information will flow from input to the output side. That is the only possible way. So we can write the weights like WNM, where N belongs to the input side and M belongs to the output side. So if we consider the jth neuron, which is being connected to Y1, okay, so we can write, that is, the weight between that is W, okay, this is for an XI neuron. So we can write WI1 in that way. If it is being connected to the jth output, then we can write WIJ in that way. So in that way the weights are being defined, in that way we can write the weights of a neural network. So this is a single layer neural network. Now see that it is convenient to consider the weights to be element of a matrix W such that W is R to the power of n cross m. Okay? So the dimensions of the weight matrix W are n rows and m columns. So n will be the rows and m will be the columns. And in general, the weighted matrix can be represented as, so we can write W for the weight. The weighted matrix can be W11, W21, WI1, WN1. Means this represents, N represents the row and M represents the column. So in that way we can write. So for an jth element, it will be W1j, W2j, WIj and WNj. In that way. So this will be the general weight matrix which can be represented by a capital W. Now for the Amory's general rule, let us consider these three vectors. Okay, the first vector is x, so that we are considering, that is the input vector, and it can be written as x1, x2, x3, xi, xn. In the same way, the net weighted input vector, that is y in, so for y in we can write y in 1, y in 2, y in 3, y in j and y in n. That will be the net weighted input vector. Now the output vector y can be written as, that is y1, y2, y3, yj and yn. So these are the three vectors that we had considered. Okay. Now see that, so the net weighted input signal at the jth output neuron can be written as, so for the jth output neuron we can write, that is we can write the summation for the jth output neuron. So for this we can write, that is y in j is equal to, that is your x1 w1j plus x2 w2j till xn wnj. And the same thing can be written as, that is sigma I is equal to 1 to n xi wij. That is for the jth neuron. So we can write for jth neuron, this will be the equation of y in j, that is the net weighted input signal at the jth output. Now see that in general, the net weighted input signal can be given as the product of the input and the weighted vector. So it can be represented as, that is y in is xw, that is the product of input vector and the weighted vector. So the net weighted signal is further processed by an activation function f to produce the output signal y. So y is nothing but, we are providing a non-linear function of y in, so that is nothing but the function of xw. So that will be the output vector, that is how the output vector is being formed for this particular neural network. So considering this general learning rule, how exactly we are going to find the w, the weight? So to do that, let us proceed further, that during the learning process, the weights that are connected to the jth output neuron denoted by wj, so that wj can be written as, that is w1j plus w2j plus w3j and wij in that. Okay, so that will be the weight vector, okay, at jth neuron till wnj. Okay, now this is going to increase in proportion to the input vector x and the learning signal l. Okay, so the learning signal is a function of the present weight values, that is wj, okay, input signal x and the teacher signal dj. So we can write, that is the change in the weight at the output jth neuron is c multiplied by l wj x dj and transpose of x, where change in wj, okay, is the change in the weight, and c is a positive learning constant. So the adopted new weight vectors is that we can write wj new is equal to wj old plus change in wj. Okay, so that will be the equation for a new weight vector. So that we are supposed to find. Okay, so after going through the generalized learning rule, let us proceed further with the HAB learning rule. Now, how it is being evolved, that we are going through in brief. That the brain learning is particularly done by the change in the synaptic gap, that is the strength of the interconnection strength between the neurons. The first person to comment upon this was a physiologist, that is Donald Hebb, in 1949. So Hebb's original statement was that when an axon of cell A, means we are considering two cells A and B which are interconnected with each other. So when an axon of cell A is near enough to excite the cell B and repeatedly or persistently takes place in firing it, some growth process or metabolic change takes place in one or both cells such that A's efficiency as one of the cells firing B is increased. So there is some metabolic process which is being involved. Because of that, one cell's efficiency will automatically increase. So the same thing is summed up like this, that increase the value of weight in the weight if the output is active when the input associated with that weight is also active. So this suggests that when the input associated to that particular weight is active, then the output is also supposed to be active, and then the weight is going to be increased. So if we assume the input x and the output y have binary values, the weight value will be incremented only when the output is 1 and the corresponding input is 1. Okay, so that is the case in HAB learning. So in 1973, Stent rephrased the HAB's hypothesis as, that is, if two neurons on either side of a synapse are activated simultaneously, then the strength of the synapse is selectively increased. And if the two neurons on either side of a synapse are activated asynchronously, then the synapse is selectively weakened or eliminated. Okay, so in 1973, Stent proposed or rephrased the Hebb's hypothesis like this. Okay, so for Hebbian rule, the weight vector increases proportional to the product of input vector and the learning signal, where the learning signal is equal to the neuron's output. Okay, so that is how the weight vector increases in a Hebbian rule. So based on the Hebbian learning rule, that is McClellan and Rumelhart in 1988 developed the HABnet. So HABnet comprising of the input neurons, the weight associated with that, and one output neuron. Okay, and this bias is being added. So in HABnet, this bias B is being added, and its value is always 1 for a HABnet. Now, that particular network is a single layer feed forward neural network, as we can see from the figure, and has a fixed bias of 1. Now see that in a particular HAMnet, the input and output patterns must be of bipolar form. Okay, otherwise it will not work properly. So the HAMnet does not learn if the input output patterns are in binary form. So this is the extreme limitation of the HAMnet. So we are supposed to take the input and output for the HAMnet as a bipolar or bipolar form. So the activation function will be bipolar in HAMnet. So let us go with the algorithm. Okay. Now see that to train a HAMnet, this is the algorithm which is being used, and even this is being used to solve the problems, okay, which is having the HAMnet. So the step one suggests that we need to initialize all the weights to 0. Means our wi is equal to 0 for I is equal to 1, 2, 3 till n, where n is the number of input neurons, as we have seen. Okay. And the bias value is also being initialized to 0. For each input vector, target output pair S colon T, we need to go for step 3 to 6. Okay. So what we are supposed to do, that set activations for input units with the input vector, that is xi is equal to si for I is equal to 1, 2, 3, n, and set the corresponding output value y is equal to t. Okay, so we will get this pair of s and t. Okay, and by applying the HAM rule, we can modify the weights. So to modify the weight, we are having this wi nu is equal to wi old plus xi y, where I is equal to 1, 2, 3 till n. And the weight will be adjusted, so by this, so the bias, adjust the bias, that is b nu is equal to b old plus y. Okay, so the above algorithm requires only one pass through the training set, and the weight update can be written in the vector form as w nu is equal to w old plus x transpose of y. Okay, so this will be the equation, where w is the column vector, x is the row vector, and y is a scalar. So this is the algorithm to train a HAMnet. Now, many times when we apply the learning rule to a problem statement, there are two things which came. The first one is linearly separable, that particular problem is linearly separable, or it is not linearly separable. So let us see what is linear separability. So the intention of training a network is to find the weights. Okay, so the first thing that we do while the learning process is to find out the weights which is best suitable for that connection, that will respond correctly when the net is presented within an input pattern that is similar to one of that the training pattern. So we must find out that whatever the input which is being given to that, we are supposed to train that if it is already present over there or not. That is the other case. So the activation function of the output neuron is a step function. Consider a sample neural net with n input neurons and one output neuron, as we had seen during the HAMnet. Now see that if the response of the output neuron is 1 for an input pattern, then the input pattern is a member of the class. Means if we get output 1 for an input pattern, then we can say that it is a member, or the class is present already, or we have defined the class. Okay? If the response of the output is minus 1, then the input pattern does not belong to the class. So if we get minus 1 as an output, then the input pattern does not belong to the class, and there is a need to specify a new class. Okay. Now, the net input to the output neuron, that is y in, can be written as, that is W0 plus sigma xi wi, okay. So using the above equation, the decision boundary between the region where y in is greater than 0 and y in is less than 0 can be determined, okay. So depending on the number of input neurons in the network, this equation represents a line or a plane or a hyperplane. So depending on this equation, when we solve, we will get an equation of a line or a plane or a hyperplane. So if it is possible to find the weights so that all of the training input vectors for which the correct response is 1 lie on the one side of the boundary, and all of the training patterns for which the correct response is -1 lie on the either side of the boundary, then the problem is linearly separable, otherwise the problems are linearly non-separable. Means whatever the input combinations that we will give to neural net, and we can find out the output for the same using the equation. So we can plot it in a way that the points are to be separated by putting the line. So it can be separated, the points which are having output 1 and the points which are having output -1. If the separation is not possible, then the problem is linearly non-separable. Okay. We will go through a few examples later on to understand that which problems are linearly separable and which one are not linearly separable. Okay. So let us start with the first example, and let us try to design or to implement an AND gate using a HAMNet. Okay. So let us first go through the design of AND gate using a HAMNet. Okay. So now see that in this, what we had done, we had started with the training patterns for an AND logic function. Okay. So you can see that the training pattern for an AND logic function, so these are the inputs. So now for the HAMNet, we are supposed to consider x1, x2 as input and b is the bias. So we can take for the input vector will become x1, x2, x3, x4. So it will be -1, 1. B will be 1. For that y1, we will get -1 for an AND gate. Okay. In the same way, for -1, 1, we will get y2, -1. For 1, -1, we will get again -1. And for 1, 1, we will get output 1. Okay. So, in this case, a single layer network with two input neurons, one bias and one output neuron is considered. Okay. So in this case, we are considering two input neurons with one bias and one output neuron. Okay. And it is a single layer network. So the initial weights are set to 0 depending on the HAM learning rule that we had seen, the algorithm that we had gone through. Okay. So depending on that algorithm, what is the first step? To set the initial weight to 0. Okay. So we write W old is equal to 0, 0, that vector. Okay. That is for x1, x2 and for bias. So we are taking the weight, the initial weight for x1, x2 and bias as 0, which is connected to the output neuron 1. Okay. So let us consider the first case. So in first case, our x1 is equal to -1, -1, 1. So this will be the first case. For that, our target y1 is -1. So we need to find out the updated weights depending on the input combination that we are given. Okay. So what we will get? We will get W mu is equal to W old plus x1 t y. Okay. So we are having this W old that we had initialized to 0. From that we are having this x1t, so we are in -1, -1, 1 multiplied with the y1, that is also -1. So when you do that, you will get 1, 1, this will become -1, so this is 0. So your W mu is 1, 1, -1 for the first case. Okay, so the W mu will be 1, 1, -1 for the first case. So in the second case, our W old will become this 1, 1, -1. Okay, in second case the x2 will be -1, 1, 1, and the output is also -1. So what we will get, so when you put this, you will get 2, 0, -2. Okay, in the same way, when you apply the third case, that is 1, -1, 1, and the corresponding target y3 is also -1, then this is your W old, you put it, and when you calculate, you will get 1, 1, -3. In the same way, when you go for the case 4, that is the fourth case, so applying the fourth input pattern, that is x4 is 1, 1, 1, and the corresponding target y4 is also 1. So for that, we will get W new is equal to W old plus, that is your x4d y4. So putting this old W old over here and putting 1, 1, 1, 1, so you will get 2, 2, -2. Okay, this will be the final weight vector that we will get, that is 2, 2, -2. So taking that weight vector, the HABNET for the AND function, that can be shown in this figure. Okay, so the HABNET for the AND function is shown as that we are having two input, one bias. Okay, so that bias we are taking 1 initially. Okay, so we are having x1, x2, and we are the neurons. Okay, and the final weight vector that we are having, that is 2, 2, -2. Okay, so that will be given to the output neuron and we'll get the output 1. So that is the HABNET implementation of AND gate. Okay. Now let us see that it is linearly separable problem or non-separable. Okay, so to do that, we can find that the AND function can be represented as a classification problem between inputs that produce 1 as output and those that produce -1 as output. Means we can classify this problem by saying that which are the input combinations for which we are getting logic 1 as output and the other combinations for which we are getting -1 as an output. So the function can be represented by means of pattern space in which the inputs represents the coordinate systems for that space, and the set of coordinates gives the position of the feature in that space. Okay, so a coordinate system can be put it like this. Okay, so this figure shows the two input variables x1 and x2, and depending on that the output points are being plotted. Okay, so for an AND gate, we can see that we are having all the points for -1, -1. Okay, then we are having for -1, 1. Okay, then we are having for 1, -1. Okay, and this is for 1, 1. Okay, so for 1, 1, we represent this cross sign, and for others we can use a dot. So we can put a decision boundary or a straight line so that these points can be separable. If we can do that, then the problem is linearly separable. If we are unable to do that, then it is not linearly separable. So in case of AND gate, we can see that these two are linearly separable. So AND gate is a linearly separable problem. Okay. So from the figure we can see that these are the four points which are being plotted. Okay, so these are the four points which are being plotted, that is -1, -1, -1, -1, -1, and -1. Okay, so this represents the position in the pattern space. Okay, so at each point the value of the output of the function y is x1 and x2 is marked as either a dot for -1 and cross for 1 that we have seen in the figure. Okay, so the value of x1 and x2 for which the net gives the positive response and the values for which it gives the negative response is known as the separating line. Okay, so this separating line can be given by this equation, that is x1w1 plus x2w2 plus b is equal to 0. Okay, that is the equation for a line that we will get. So for end function, our final weight vector is, that is 2, 2, -2. So if you put the final weight vector in that particular equation, so we will get 2x1 plus 2x2 minus 2 is equal to 0, or x2 is equal to minus of x1 plus 1. Okay, so this is the boundary condition that we are having, that x2 is equal to minus x1 plus 1. Okay, so the straight line, that is x2 is equal to minus x1 plus 1, separates the pattern space into two regions. So this problem is referred to as linearly separable problem. Okay, so by this you can say that it is a linearly separable problem. In the same way, when you are going to implement an OR function, the same process is to be followed and you will find that it is linearly separable. In the same way, when you go with AND NOT function implementation, you will find that it is linearly separable. Okay, so let us see one example for linearly non-separable problem. Okay, so let us go with a linearly non-separable problem. So that is nothing but the XOR implementation. Okay, so for XOR implementation, we are having this linearly non-separable part. Okay, so let us start with the HABNET implementation of XOR function. Okay, so as we have seen, the training patterns for the XOR function that we are supposed to see first. Okay, so the training patterns, so we are going for the XOR function implementation. Okay, so for XOR function, the training patterns will be that we are considering two inputs. We are considering two inputs, one bias and one output neuron. So two input neurons will be there, one bias and one output neuron. Okay, so for this the training patterns will be, so we are having the input side, so on input side we are having x1, x2 and a bias, and on the target side, that is on the output side, we are having y as the output. Okay, so initially we call them as, that is the x1 x2 x3 and x4, that are the neurons. Okay, and similarly on the output we will get y1 y2 y3 and y4. Okay, so let us consider the cases for the input. So for input, the x1 and x2 we are having, that is for -1 -1 for XOR, and for bias 1 we get the output -1. Again, for -1 1 1 we will get 1, for 1 -1 1, we will get 1. In the same way, for 1, 1, 1, we will get minus 1. Okay. So we are considering a single layer neural network, and in that single layer neural network, we are considering 2 input neurons, 1 bias, and 1 output neuron. Okay. Is it clear? So the initial weights that we are supposed to set, so this is our training patterns. Okay. So depending on the training pattern, what we will initialize W old is equal to 0, 0, 0. We will initialize W old to 0, 0, 0. Okay. So the W old will be 0, 0, 0. That is the first step we are going with. Okay. So let us start with the case 1 training pattern we had seen for XOR function. So after seeing the training pattern, let us start with case 1. Now in case 1, our x1 vector that will get minus 1, minus 1, 1, and we are having y1 is equal to minus 1. So our w nu we are supposed to calculate. So w nu is equal to, that is w old plus, that is x1 t y1. So putting the w old 0, 0, 0, and putting the values of input vector, that is minus 1, minus 1, 1, multiplied with minus 1. Okay. So when we solve this, when we are going to solve this, we will get the final weight as 1, 1, minus 1. That will be our W nu for the first case. So for first case, our W nu will be, that is 1, 1, minus 1. Okay. So let us go with the case 2. Let us go with case 2. Let us start with case 2. So for case 2, we can see that we are supposed to consider x2, that is minus 1, 1, 1, and for that our y2 is 1. So the w old that we had found earlier, that is 1, 1, minus 1, that we are supposed to add with minus 1, 1, 1, multiplied by 1. So finally, when we solve this, when we are going to solve this, we will get, that is 0, 0, 2, 0. After solving this, we will get 0, 2, 0 as our new weight vector. Okay. So that is the case 2. So let us go with the case 3. So we want x3. So for x3, it is 1, minus 1, 1, output is 1. Okay. So for case 3, now this will become our W old. So we can write plus, that is 1, minus 1, 1, t multiplied by 1. Okay, this much we will get. Okay, so finally we will get, that is 1, 1, 1, t after solving this. Okay, so in case 4, when we apply the fourth case, when we go for the fourth case, when we go for the fourth case, then this will be the 111 will be the WO for the fourth case. Okay. So if we consider the fourth case, so for fourth case we are having 1 minus 1 1, no, it is 1 1 1, and for that our output is minus 1. So W volt that we are finding is 1 1 1 plus, it will become 1 1 1 transpose of that and minus. Okay, so when we solve it, we will get 0 0 0 as the final weight vector. Okay, now the final weight vector we will get is 0 0 0, so it is unable to solve the problem, because when we plot it in the coordinate system, when we see this function in the coordinate system, what we will get is that if I draw this input output in a coordinate system for an XOR function, so if that is the x1 we are having, if this is the x2 we are having, okay, so if we plot, this will be the combination, okay, dot represents the minus 1 and cross represents the plus 1 output that we are getting from the output neuron. So we can say that this problem is not linearly separable, that we cannot draw a straight line to separate this two different outputs that we are having. Okay, so an XOR is a typically non-separable or linearly non-separable problem. Okay, the others like AND or NOT and NOT, okay, all these are linearly separable problems. Is it clear? Okay, so your XOR function is not linearly separable. Okay, so let us proceed further and solve one more example of a TC problem that will help to understand the concept or to apply a HAPnet. Okay, so normally it is a pattern recognition problem. So in this pattern recognition problem, okay, there are two grids are being given. It is also known as TC problem, which can be solved using the HAPnet. So we are using HAPnet to solve this TC problem. Okay, so we are supposed to put this T and C. So we are having this T and C like this. So we are going for a pattern recognition problem. So if this is the T that we are making in a 3 cross 3 matrix. So these are the T and C, that is the TC representation in a 3 cross 3 matrix. Okay. Then let us first go for the training pattern. Let us first go with the training pattern. So the training pattern, so we are having only two patterns, that is T and C only. We are having inputs and we do have a target. Okay. So the training pattern that we can write is for x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8 and x9, and we take B target, we are having 1, y. Okay. So where the cross is there we will put 1, where the cross is not there we will put minus 1. Okay, that is the case. Okay. So for T we are having 1, 1, if we are considering x1, x2, x3 in that way, so 1, 1, 1, then we are having minus 1, 1, minus 1, okay, and lastly we are having, minus 1, 1, minus 1, b we will take 1, for that we are considering the output as 1, so this will be for t, that is the x1, x2, x3, where the cross is there we will take 1, where it is not there we will take minus. In the same way, for c we can consider, that is the x1, x2, x3 will be 1, 1, 1, then it will be 1, minus 1, minus 1, and then we are having 1, 1, 1, and the bias will be 1, and for this if we take the target as minus 1. Okay, so for applying the HAPnet, what actually we will do, we will initialize all the weights with 0 according to the algorithm that we have done. Okay, so we will write W old for this, so we will put or make them in 3 because we have taken a 3 cross 3 matrix, and don't forget the bias. Okay, so we will initialize all of them as 0. Okay, so try to understand the problem statement that we are considering a TC problem and we need to implement this TC problem. Okay, so we are considering a 3 cross 3 matrix. It is a typical pattern recognition problem that we are going through. Okay, so we are having this pattern TC. Okay, and in that we are just putting 1 for cross and minus 1 for that. So this is the training pattern that we had made for the TC problem. Okay, so initially we will initialize the old weight with 0. So we are initializing it with 0. Okay, so let us proceed further for solving this problem. Okay, so to solve this, let us proceed further. So let us consider the case 1. Let us consider the case 1. For case 1, our x1 will be this one. Okay, so that will be our x1, and our y1 will be this one. Okay, so we can write directly now that W nu is equal to, that is W old plus, we are having, that is x1 t y1. Okay, so for this our W old, we know, okay, that from this we can directly write, so it is 0, so we are having only this product. Okay, so we will get 1, 1, 1, comma, minus 1, 1, minus 1, comma, minus 1, 1, minus 1, and 1. So after putting it, you will get this. Okay, so our x1 is this one, this one is the x1, okay, along with the bias, and so we will get the same thing. So we are having this 1, 1, 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, and 1. Okay, that's it. So this will be our W nu. So this will be the W nu. Okay, now see that for case 2, applying the same equation, now our W old will be this one. Okay, so our W old, we are writing the same, that is 1, 1, 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1, minus 1, 1, plus we are taking this as for y2, and this will be the x2, and this will be the y2. So x2 is our, that is 1, 1, 1, okay, then 1, minus 1, minus 1, the same thing we are having over here, 1, 1, 1, 1 we are taking bias, and the output is minus 1. So this we are considering the output as minus 1 over here. Okay, so when we solve this, finally we will get the weight vector as 0, 0, 0, minus 2, 0, minus 2, comma 0. So this would be the final weight matrix, okay? And the HALFNET for the TC problem, the HALFNET for the TC problem, which is having this final weight, that is 0, 0, 0, minus 2, 0, minus 2, 0, minus 2, 0. So that we are supposed to draw from case 1 and case 2. Okay. So, and HALFNET for a TC problem which is having 9 input neurons. So we are having x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8 and x9 as the input neurons for that particular HALFNET, okay, which are having the inputs x1, x2, x3, x4, x5, x6, x7, x8 and x9. Okay, so these are the input neurons, and the output that we will have, that is the y, okay, and finally we will get the output y. And for HALFNET we are also considering a bias 1. So for our output vector from case 2, this value of b is 0, so that we are putting, and all this are to be connected, all this are to be connected. All these are to be connected like this, and we are determining the weights for that. Okay, so we will put the weights, that is 0, 0, 0 for this, minus, minus 2, 2, 0 for this, and minus 2, 0, minus 2 for this. Okay. So our final weight vector that we are having, that is W is equal to, that is 0, 0, 0, comma, minus 2, 2, 0, minus 2, 0, minus 2, comma, 0. This is the final weight vector that we get, okay. So the TC problem can be implemented using the HALFNET, and we are applying the HALF learning rule. So the final weight vector that we will get is this one. So this is the implementation of a pattern recognition problem like TC problem. That is a very simple and a basic pattern recognition problem that we have discussed. Okay. So that is all about regarding the HALF learning rule. Okay. So that's all we have for today's lecture. So next time when we'll meet, we will start with the delta rule, and we will see the general delta rule for learning. Thank you.